Now that we have, as Spinoza suggested, devised a means for improving and clarifying the intellect, we are prepared at last to explore the ethics. When reading the ethics, do not think that by running through it quickly, you will understand it fully. Every part depends on preceding parts. You will not understand any important section thoroughly till you have read and pondered the whole. Sadly, I will not be able to capture the whole of its grandeur in this video. What I hope is that I am able to expatiate on its most essential lessons and principles. In an attempt to make the ethics comprehensible, Spinoza constructs it in geometrical form, but the result is a work of philosophy that is neither clear nor comprehensible. He acknowledges the apparent complexity of the ethics, but consoles and reassures us, saying, "Doubtless, the reader will become confused and will recollect many things which will bring him to a standstill. Therefore, I pray him to proceed gently with me and form no judgment concerning these things until he shall have read all." Have patience with this video as well. I assure you, we will come to its core principles soon enough. But first, we should clarify bits of Spinoza's terminology, lest we should misunderstand his message. For the sake of this video, we will only define two important terms, substance and mode. Think of substance not as anything material, as we would speak of marble as the substance of a statue, but instead, substance, as Spinoza understands it, is that which eternally and unchangeably is, and of which everything else must be a transient form. These forms are what Spinoza refers to as modes. This is any individual thing or event, including you, your body, and even your thoughts. He identifies substance with God and nature. "I hold that God is the immanent and not the extraneous cause of all things. I say all is in God, all lives and moves in God." He does not mean to convey to his readers that God and nature are one and the same, but that like substance, God is the underlying reality in which the processes of nature occur. Natural law is but the eternal commandments of God. This means, to the Catholic Church's abhorrence, that God was not some omnipresent man ordering countless persecutions, but was instead only nature and its laws. He would also go on to address our timeless problem of evil. Spinoza asserted that philosophers often make the mistake of attempting to reconcile evil with an all-powerful and completely good God. Take Leibniz's best of all possible worlds as an example. Good and evil are but anthropocentric delusions, subjective assertions. For the spider to live, the fly has to die. For the fly to live, the spider must starve. Whenever, then, anything in nature seems to us ridiculous, absurd, or evil, it is because we have but a partial knowledge of things, and are in the main ignorant of the order and coherence of nature as a whole, and because we want everything to be arranged according to the dictates of our own reason. Although, in fact, what our reason pronounces as bad is not bad as regards the order and laws of universal nature, but only as regards the laws of our own nature taken separately. What of Spinoza's position on free will? I will let him tell you in his own words. "There is in the mind no absolute or free will, but the mind is determined in willing this or that by a cause which is determined in its turn by another cause, and this by another, and so on to infinity. We only think that we are free because we are conscious of our desires, but Spinoza informs us that most are ignorant of the causes that lead us to these desires." The Ethic of Spinoza. Of all the profound moral philosophies that populate history, there are but three that stand predominant: that of Buddha and Jesus, that of Machiavelli and Nietzsche, and that of Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. As Durant so accurately said, it is the distinction of Spinoza that his ethic unconsciously reconciles these apparently hostile philosophies, weaves them into a harmonious unity, and gives us in consequence a system of morals which is the supreme achievement of modern thought. In his ethic, happiness is the ultimate goal, the apogee of all human conduct. He would define happiness very simply as the presence of pleasure in the absence of pain. To him, pleasure and pain are merely transitions, pain being one's transition from a greater state of perfection to a lesser, and pleasure being the antithesis of pain. He would equate power with virtue, and thought joy only comes when our power is increased, The more a man can preserve his being and seek what is useful to him, the greater is his virtue. In the same sense, emotions are only good or bad insofar as they positively or negatively impact our power. So, he stands behind a justifiable egoism and lays it down as his foundation on which virtue is built. He has no use for humility or remorse, but admires modesty. Unjustifiable pride is also something Spinoza rejects. And for society to overcome its shortcomings, the individuals that populate it must conquer these undesirable emotions. To do this, we must endeavor to understand. Passion should come secondary to reason. Instincts are magnificent as a driving force, but dangerous as guides. When we decide, then, to adopt a deterministic philosophic model, we also adopt the fortitude to bear up under any circumstance, to recognize the necessity of all things, and to see them as not harmful nor beneficial. As Nietzsche would go on to say, "That which is necessary does not offend me. Amor fati is the core of my nature." Spinoza and religion. Spinoza's view on religion and immortality are best summarized here with this epilogue. Our mind, insofar as it understands, is an external mode of thinking, which is determined by another mode of thinking, and this one again by another, and so on to infinity, so that they all constitute at the same time the eternal and infinite intellect of God. And with this, we should continue on to his fourth and final work, Tractatus Politicus, the political treatise. While this work would remain unfinished due to his untimely death, it would, nonetheless, bring clarity to his political views. Men are not born for citizenship, but must be made for it. This is to say that before civilizations were formed, individuals lived apart without conceptions of right and wrong. Might was right. It is only through accepted organization that the might of the individual becomes the might of the state. The individual, seeing that survival is much more of a guarantee with mutual aid, concedes his own individual power to the power of the whole. From here arises the development of morality and conscience, since these things are necessary for the survival of the whole. Let Spinoza explain, in his own words, the necessity of social organization. The last end of the state is not to dominate men, nor to restrain them by fear. Rather, it is so to free each man from fear that he may live and act with full security and without injury to himself or his neighbor. The end of the state, I repeat, is not to make rational beings into brute beasts and machines. It is to enable their bodies and their minds to function safely. It is to lead men to live by and exercise a free reason, that they may not waste their strength in hatred, anger, and guile, nor act unfairly toward one another. Thus, the end of the state is really liberty. Freedom of thought and freedom of speech are essential to maintaining the stability of the state. It is for this reason that Spinoza expressed a preference for democracy. In this form of governance, everyone submits to the control of authority over his actions, but not over his judgment and reason, i.e., seeing that all men cannot think alike, the voice of the majority has the force of law. Democracy does, however, have its troubles, for instance, its propensity for electing demagogues into office. The only remedy, Spinoza thought, was to limit office to those trained for the cause. For some time after his death, the world would sadly hold him in ill repute. This was until the German writer Lessing restored his name to its rightful place among the geniuses of history. All those who endeavor to follow the philosophic path should know him. It was Hegel who declared that, to be a philosopher, one must first be a Spinozist. I can only say that Hegel was right, and that I too implore whoever hears this to discover our gentle philosopher. It would be near impossible to fit so much matter into this video, lest I kept you here another hour. I hope, however, that I was able to adequately capture the essence of his work. If you enjoyed this video or found it helpful in any way, consider subscribing and turning on the notification bell for more on Eastern and Western philosophy. And as always, thank you for talking philosophy with me. Until next time.